What's good, guys? Welcome back to the channel. Today we are going to be breaking down a live event capture slash concert film reel. This is mine from the past year that I'll be showing in the background. I totally understand how difficult it can be to create a film reel in this niche. There's not many examples, and I was asking the same questions you are just about a year ago when I was first making mine. Some of the questions I would ask would be, do I open up old projects? Do I just take the final videos and chop those up? What if I did multiple clips from one video, all in order, and then went on to the next venue and or artist? And how would it look if I did a combination of that and mixed together all kinds of different clips from different videos? I'm gonna answer these questions plus way more so that we can help you grab the attention of an artist, venue, concert, festival, you name it, that you wanna work for, whether it be photos or video. Jumping into the final quarter of the year, you should have captured some insane footage by now. Let's make sure that you can showcase your work, get it to the right people, and create a film reel of your own. Dope, with that out of the way, let's break down the introduction to this video. I consider the introduction for my video to be up until the first 12 to 15 seconds when the song is building up. I'm gonna tell you guys three things that need to be a part of the introduction to your video. One, this is your chance to grab the audience's attention and reel them in for the rest of the video. Use only your best shots here. Second, tell the audience or viewer what they can expect from the rest of this video. I would do this by picking wide opening shots that set the scene. An example of this would be packed out venues, the whole festival, concert, stage, a super wide shot of the artist, all things that I included in mine. Lastly, to tell the viewer what they can expect from this video, make sure to have a title sequence explaining what the video is going to be with your name and what they can expect. And the final thing that should be a part of your introduction is to keep it short. I would say anywhere between 12 to 15 seconds and use it as the buildup of both the song and your video. So that right when you get to that buildup, the drop comes, it gets hectic, and now they're reeled in. Now that we hit the climax of the video, we can incorporate a bunch of different strategies to keep the viewer watching and keep up audience retention. Throughout my video, I use the following strategies, and I'm gonna break them down as the video goes on. My take on the picture effect, speed ramping, shot variation, match cutting, in-camera transitions, shutter lag, pacing, sound design, and song choice. Combining these strategies and effects together is gonna give your video an incredibly cohesive viewing experience, and ultimately result in the viewer being like, for some reason, this video just felt really good, and I watched the whole thing. This is due to a handful of psychological reasons that we are going to take advantage of. As we're trying to grab attention, I started off with a picture effect that's really unique to my style and is something that many people might not have seen before. My idea is that not very often do you see photos included inside of a video and in a non-static way. So the way I was able to achieve this is I'm taking photos that I've taken throughout this past year. Some of my favorite ones, of course, since you're trying to grab attention and showcase the best of your work. I combine those with this Kodak 3200 film cut that I got from Jacob Owens. I throw an 8mm film grain on top. I basically just went to opacity and then switched this to overlay. And then I included some 4K old grain scratches just to rough it up a little bit. And then lastly, this is the title sequence that I created in Photoshop. I personally like creating all of my title sequences in Photoshop rather than Premiere Pro. It just goes faster and I feel like I have more control. Like I mentioned earlier, this is something super important to have in your own video to showcase and tell the audience what they can expect from the rest of the video. Tyler Cavallaro directed, shot, and edited Event Capture Reel 2021. So if we slide by, you can also see if we go frame by frame that this one is about 10 frames. The next one is about 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And as we move further, they get shorter and shorter. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And we're into the next photo. So when we play that out, I also want you to pay attention to the sound that you can hear, because right here, I included some photo clicks, which really sell the effect as if you're looking at a slideshow or that the photos are really moving, not just a static photo with text. Accompanied with that, I'll get into it in further detail later, we have a riser, which you can hear here. And that is accompanied with a bass hit, which you can see right here. This is obviously also just guiding the viewer and keeping their attention just a little bit further, trying to take advantage of every tactic that you can. Lastly, to polish it off and really sell off the effect, I included this WGFX. As you can see in the effects corner here, this is an effect I found online, and it kind of just does a motion blur collapse, and it really sells the effects that we were just watching pictures go by, like it's the actual shutter of a camera. I would definitely try to include something that is unique to your style, that's different and fresh, that the viewer might not have seen before, to capture their attention right at the start, like I did with this picture effect. This worked out super well for me, honestly, because the first festival I ever got into, I snuck into, so I didn't really get the best video as there were way too many people in front of me, but I did get some incredible photos, like the ones that I just included in that. This was my way of coping with the problem that I didn't get that many great videos, but I did get some good photos. After this effect, you can see some wide establishing shots, once again explaining the viewer what they can expect from the rest of this video. Artists, talent, DJs, in super packed venues. Jumping into strategy number two, this is speed ramping. A perfect example of that is this right here. This is a perfect way to get in and out of a shot in the fastest way possible, something you definitely want to be doing in the introduction of your video. Not only does it do that, but it creates flow. Let me explain. The shot prior of Gucci Mane, you can see, is kind of slow, so the next shot should naturally be slow. But as you can see, it begins to speed up. If I open up this nested sequence, and maybe we can see it better, I use this here, show clip keyframes, time ramping, and then what you can do is add a keyframe, make the speed of the clip go faster, like I've done here. I'm gonna undo that. And as you can see, at this part, it begins to speed up. So let's watch that through. So if we recall, we went from a slow clip to a slow clip to speeding up, speed up, and slow. That creates flow. Slow, fast, fast, slow. And then you keep the momentum going. And I just wanted to point out that this creates continuity. Slow to fast, fast to slow. Whether you reverse those around, you do fast, slow, slow, fast. The brain loves continuity, and we do this in a handful of ways, not only by speed ramping, but by match cutting, which I'll explain further in the video. The reason it feels so good watching that is because it's not creating something jarring or abrupt. It's not going from fast to slow, and then fast again, and slow, and then it's just creating fast, slow, slow, fast, kind of like a little hill or like a roller coaster, you know what I mean? It's not taking you out of the viewing experience. It's making it very easy to follow along. Third on the list is shot variation. As I let the video play out, you're gonna see we want close-up, wide-angle shots of hands, not just of the artist or the talent, of the crowd. You wanna try interacting with the crowd, interact with the DJ like I did there. That's another example of an in-camera transition I'll break down further in the video. Here, I'm panning the camera from down. I tell the DJ put his hands up, interact with him, and then he puts his hands down. I pan the camera down quickly, and then I have this shot at a festival where I start up and I come down, making it seem like we kind of just like teleported, you know what I mean? We were just at a club with the DJ, and now we're in the audience and smoke's going off and lights are going off. Yes, this is the festival I snuck into. So yeah, I'm gonna let the video play out and explain some kind of shots that you can get using shot variation. I personally recommend shots of the artist, DJ, or talent interacting with the audience and or performing. You can get different shots of the crowd interacting with the camera, clapping, waving their hands, phone flashlights. You can get their emotions. Are they happy? Is this a super sentimental song? That's how you can kind of create flow throughout the video. Definitely make sure to get different shots of the venue, festival, concert itself. Stand in the back of the crowd, in front of the crowd, get on the stage, go all the way in the back so that you can see the entire crowd and how packed it is. Maybe you get a shot just above head level with everybody with their hands up. Get those intricate details of the stage that someone put so much time into making sure they were perfect. And make sure you get any logos and or visual boards that are behind the artists and or on the stage itself. If you're at shows where there's smoke and visual effects or lasers, make sure you're getting all that kind of stuff too. That's a great example. Smoke going off, you hear the smoke going off, crowd, their hands, lights in the background. Hopefully those were a handful of examples. Wrapping up shot variation, just try to get creative with it. Think outside the box, where a certain photographer or videographer might not go, or some uncommon locations. Maybe you get to the second floor, over the stage, in the corner, and try to get that unique angle. For the fourth point in this video, we're gonna be talking about match cutting. This is what I was talking about previously when I mentioned continuity. Throughout my video, as it's really fast paced, I just try to keep the artist or the talent DJ in the center of the frame. As we can see here, all of this is with the talent in the center. Center. If I keep my mouse here, you can see a common concept. Center of the frame. Center of the frame. Center of the frame. Break it up. Back in the center. Same thing. The way you can keep track of this is by using the rule of thirds. Last example I'm going to give of continuity and match cutting is, you can see the artist right in the center where I have my mouse. I have the same shot of the artist. It should be right or close to where my mouse was. You can see that between the two shots, they're pretty similar where the artist is. What we're doing here is creating an easy way for the brain not to have to do a lot of work and search where the neck area of focus might be. If all of a sudden I'm here and now I'm here and then I'm there, just not pleasing at all. If we open up this shot, actually you can see that there's a lot of different parts that I could have used, and I decided to use the part where he was closest to the center. Now, if they're not, what you can do is zoom in just a little bit and boom, move them right to the center, kind of reframe it, and there you go. Again, this is just adding to a cohesive video viewing experience and trying to keep the viewer engaged in the video and having to make them do the least amount of work possible so that they can keep watching. In reality, what you're doing throughout this entire video is fighting for their attention. Why should they pick you? Make it as easy as possible that they pick you. Incorporate these strategies, these effects that I'm talking about. Number 5 on our list of effects and strategies, we got in-camera transitions, something that is super unique to my specific style in the nightlife concert artist scene. It's very difficult to pull it off, but when you do, man, it's just incredible. Looking at this video here, you're able to see how I really do this. I can hear the buildup of the song coming, so I keep it steady, and I'm anticipating a drop, and when the drop comes, I'm gonna flick the camera up. See right there? I'm looking at the audience, I hear the drop, I point the camera at the sky, and there's the drop. Worked out perfect. And then from here on out, what I kind of do is I pan the camera from left to right, as that's just kind of my style. You can see a perfect example of that here. Maybe I'd like to, now, that's the festival I snuck into. This is a club that I actually didn't sneak into and I got hired to work for. This is also a good example of me moving the camera around in those twisting and turning ways. I'm not doing that at all with the transform tools. Here, you can see, I start with the camera pointed at the DJ booth below, and this camera, with this transition, I'm doing that turning thing. And as you can see, I spin the camera and I kind of turn it upwards. So I take that as a great idea, as since I'm going towards the roof with the ends of this transition, I'm going up towards the roof and it's black, I decide to start what we're seeing is black. So in this case scenario, it worked out that the DJ booth below it is black. It was super dark. And when I pan the camera up, following what I did from the previous transition where I was going up towards the roof, now we're following continuity and match cutting, where panning the camera upwards as well, following the motion, and we see the DJ. It starts from dark, you get to see what's going on. The DJ throws his hands up, I'm interacting with him, we plan this, and as he throws his hands down, I follow the motion of his hands, so we pan the camera downwards. And what this tells me is we went back to the black area. So what I can do now is anything that's black from this start of the video, I can start from the back of a bookshelf and pan out to somebody studying. That night that I was at this festival, which was probably more than a year and a half later, I just had this idea to stitch them together way later on. This was black, just like the bottom of this DJ booth. This is still, the yellow is this clip and the green is the festival clip. As you can see, we're at black now. Now we're into the next clip, but this is the sky of that festival. It was at nighttime and it's black. So as we pan down, we see the color and we do it to right to the drop of the song. So if we let that all play out again, spinning, in-camera transitions, pair that up with a planned one, boom, in the festival. Right after that, we see some speed ramping. This is just a steady shot, but we go from slow to fast, fast to slow. If we look at this shot, in reality, what I'm doing is just spinning the camera. Let's see if we can find this. This shot that I'm opening up is that same shot. Let's see how I shot it. Totally different, it's just steady. Now I decide to spin. Smoke went off at the same time, I just got lucky. But yeah, moving camera forwards, walking with it backwards, getting close up to the talent. And out of that entire 22 second clip, I decided to use this. I'm kind of zooming, walking forward with the camera and spinning it. The smoke goes off. I knew right there that was the shot that I wanted. Watch that all together with some color grading. This is what we get. Slow to fast, boom. We also kind of pair that up with his hands moving super fast with the speed ramp and it kind of being like a, all right, you got it. All right, this is what's up, smoke. Super cool in my opinion. For me, it just kind of feels like, now you get the smoke. This is speed ramped as well. We start off fast, we slow down, and it's right on the artist. Fast, again, center of the frame, same area. Don't make it too jarring, all center of the frame. Last two things I wanna mention about in-camera transitions, as you just saw in those examples, I'm kinda just moving the camera in whichever direction, and in post-production, I'm stitching all of the things together. This is a pretty crazy way to try and produce an in-camera transition, but because I like filming a lot, and my theory is I'd rather film way too much than way too little, just deal with it after, this works out for me. You can plan out these in-camera transitions like I have. I just personally come up with them on the fly, but you can also plan them out and discuss it with them before, and this will make your life a lot easier. But definitely don't feel like you have to plan them out. Number six, we're gonna be talking about shutter lag. This is something I learned from Jacob Owens. I followed what he did exactly. You can play around with it as well. I do too, just a little bit. You wanna start taking photos, but put your shutter speed at 1/10. So you obviously have to be shooting in manual. Put the drive mode to high and start moving the camera backwards and forwards and spinning and moving to the side. Let me show an example of how I've utilized that here. I didn't do it too much because it is very jarring right here, and I obviously paired that with a sound effect that we can see here, like a little gear winding. If we mute the song, we should be able to hear it way better. I have a film burn. If we mute all of these, that's the film burn that I decide to add. Usually what I'll do too, yeah, exactly. I'll mess around with the opacity of it. If we looked at it normally, this is what the film burn would look like. I decided to throw linear light on there. I put a crosshair as well. This is just something I found online and or got from somebody's pack over the years. I don't really recall, honestly. Added some 8mm film grain, one of my personal favorites, really roughs up the image. We mute all those tracks, we should be able to see it. Let that play out, you can see the gray. And then lastly, I included the clip itself. Let's open this up, actually. Now we can really see the photos. I just colored them up in Lightroom, and that's how they played out. I didn't use the entire thing, but this is what it looked like in that burst of photos. You can see how it creates that blur, and you have it in drive. I'm kind of just following the artist, moving the camera, panning with them, moving backwards, forwards. And then when we piece all those things together now, this is what we get. Super fast, but when you pair it with a sound effect, it really was like, whoa, what was that? I want to keep watching, at least in my opinion. Another example of where I used that is right here. This was in my 2C video. If we open up this nested sequence, we can see the photos. This, it looks like I did way more than 1/10 of a second, and or I just moved the camera way more, but it's a shot of the audience with their hands up. Obviously edited in Lightroom. This time I didn't decide to add any film grain, film burn, crosshair overlay on it. I just did it by itself and added that sound effect. We mute all the tracks and just this one. You can hear it. It doesn't sound at all like a camera shutter, but it does get the point across. Right then and there, you also heard the smoke as the smoke goes off. Let's mute all those tracks as well because we are getting to the sound design part soon. Here's just the smoke. So let's move on to pacing. The best way to achieve pacing, in my opinion, is cutting to the beat of the song. Cutting to the beat of the song is gonna create flow. You can create flow by doing this. When the song slows down, you pick slower, longer shots and longer cuts. A good example of that would be towards the end. These are very long shots in comparison to all the rest of the video. And if we pick a faster part where the song had just dropped about here, fast, 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 slow. Beat change, bass hit, bass hit, bass hit, bass, 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 slow. Song really slows down. That's how we're creating pacing. That's gonna create pacing. It's not that difficult to create if you follow the movement of the song, the feel of the song. Last but not least, we are going to be discussing sound design and song choice. If we look at my timeline here, I didn't get too crazy with the sound design. Let's hear the video without sound design first and only the song. You might not hear anything different right now. Definitely still feels good, but honestly to me it sounds super jarring right now. Because it doesn't feel immersive, it doesn't feel like I'm there. I see audience, I hear cheering, I see an audience, I see a talent performing, but I don't hear the crowd. I see smoke on the screen, but I don't hear it. So it just kind of makes me feel like I'm not there. So what we do to make the viewing experience more immersive, the entire thing we're trying to do throughout this video, is we add all of these things. When you see photos move, you think of a camera clicking. So I add a camera clicking. With the drop, I'm adding a... So it's really building up. It's keeping you into the video. I'm adding audience. Ooh, yeah, cheering. When you see smoke, I have a psh. You hear smoke. So let's watch it now with all the sound effects. Camera clicking. Here you hear the audience. Gucci. Smoke. Audience getting louder. Camera clicking. Yeah, the biggest thing I would say is honestly audience cheering. Let's find a prime example of that here. There you hear it. Let's add it all together now. Audience cheering plus music and other sound effects. And it kind of drowns it out. It doesn't make it feel as abrupt and jarring. Now, because you're paying attention to, you might really hear audience. It's back again right here. Let's see. Boom. Let's listen to just the audience. Now all together. Feels immersive, feels like you're there, how it should be. Now I'm sure you're wondering, where can you find these sound effects? How can you include them in your video as well? Honestly, what I've done over the years is just collect them myself, but prior to that, and still sometimes, I use Epidemic Sound, I use YouTube, I use freesound.org, and yeah, those are all the methods I've used in the past to capture audience cheering. What you can kind of look up is just audience clapping, audience ambiance, festival crowd. As for song choice, find a popular artist or a song that really blew up this year and something you don't mind editing a lot to and or hearing. For my case, I shoot a lot of EDM shows, but EDM didn't feel right as I had a lot of artists, talents, rappers inside of the video as well, and I felt like it couldn't match right, and it's really what everybody would do. And on the flip side, rap had a lot of profanity in it, and that just didn't feel professional to me. So I settled with a slower song that still has a cool build-up and is still dope from a popular artist that year, St. John. This is the song I stumbled upon. Shout out to Ryan. If you're watching this, you know what's up. I obviously didn't use copyright-free music. As we get to the conclusion, I want to make sure that it's very understandable where we're heading with the video. We're closing it out. Song slows down, we slow down. Not, I wouldn't say in-camera transition, but kind of match cutting. He's throwing his hands up, shot of, again, kind of, yeah, people throwing their hands up and the camera panning upwards. end off on a really cool note, and we have our conclusion. Let the music fade out, you hear firework sounds, you saw fireworks in the previous clip, so it kind of just felt right to me. Something messed up, but I did a cool effect with the song where I added some, let's see if we can mess around with it. I added some studio reverb. We go into there, and I think I did outside club. See what that sounds like. Something like that right here now. I also definitely hit Command R and slowed down the song. Just like that. For your end sequence, I would definitely put your contact information on the screen like I have here. Your email would be best, your name. Before wrapping up the video, I want to answer some of the questions that you might have had and the questions that I posed at the start of this video. Creating a film reel, do I open up old projects? I'm gonna throw a question back at you. I say yes and no. The question you should ask yourself is, are you proud of how the final video turned out? Then yes, throw in the final video. If you're not and you only like certain shots, but some shots aren't long enough to include in the film reel or they don't exactly match, open up the old project, drag them into the new one, and make the adjustments as you see needed. Second question, do I take the final video and chop it up and use it in multiple parts of my film reel? I definitely made use of this. I took final videos, and as you saw, there were multiple instances where I included Waka Flocka, Gucci Mane, 2C, some of the most popular artists I shot that year, and put them not only at the start, but the beginning, the middle, and the end. Not only did I use the final video though, the final export that I sent off to the client, I also opened up the project, and if I felt, like I said previously, the clips weren't long enough, I extended them. Honestly, the answer to this question, I say do what feels right. For the third question, should I do multiple clips of one artist, like 20 to 25 seconds of just shots of Gucci Mane? Should I do... I played around with this and I actually have two renditions of this film reel. I have one for somebody who got me to work for all of these artists, and he wanted the logo at the bottom and shots of the artist for 20 to 25 seconds and really showcase the best of what we can do for them. This works. It's not the one I decided to run with. The one that I decided to run with is really just a mix of single shots and final videos. This is because I didn't really work with the artist directly. I more so worked for the venue, so I didn't have time to accumulate 25 to 30 seconds of the most banger shots of that specific artist. And even if I did, I'd probably still just pick the best five and include them in separate parts of the video. Maybe one or two clips of them next to one another so you see them back to back, but more than that, I don't think so. Once again, entirely up to you. Final question, should I mix the videos in a completely random order? I definitely did this. It wasn't completely random. I just did what felt right for the video corresponding to the song. We've made it to the end of the video. I threw my timeline up in the background. With that being said though, I hope I answered all of your questions in regards to creating a nightlife, concert, film reel, event capture reel. If you have any further questions, feel free to drop them in the comment section below. I'd be more than thrilled to answer them. I know I wished I had someone to ask these questions to when I first started. And if you decide to use a lot of these tips and strategies, tag me in your film reel. I'd love to see it. That's it for today though. Hope you guys enjoyed, and I'll catch you guys in the next video. Peace.